I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes.
Exercise your imagination. This week, Tony Hillerman's haunting tour of terror. The Blessing Way. Starring Ed Nelson. Barbara Anderson. And Tige Anders. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by
Metropolitan Life Insurance Company and the Ford Motor Company. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Dr. Bergen McKee has seen the bodies of two murdered men. He's seen the expression of utter terror frozen on their still faces. Two men, one a young Navajo running from the law, the other a university professor like himself. And he has met the murderer. In fact, at this moment, Dr. Bergen McKee is being held captive by the one who buried those two men alive. And he's not alone. Miss Ellen Leon is with him. And that's the rub. McKee is a man betrayed by a woman. He's been asked to write a letter explaining the disappearance of three people. One he knows is already dead. Dr. Bergen McKee must bargain for time, because that letter, if written, will surely be his epitaph. The conclusion of this week's story, The Blessing Way, follows after this word.
Ellen and I work furiously, racing the light of day. There was no sound from outside, so we had to be especially quiet in our work. Finally, we'd cleared away enough rock so that there was a hole large enough to squeeze through.
Where do you think it goes?
I don't know. The Hopis are smart people. My guess is, since we're on a side cliff, it leads up. It's better.
What if Eddie's out there?
Chances are he is. But down below. Now, you wait here. I just want to see if there's a way out. Be right back. I crawled through the hole and found myself in another smaller room, leading out to a shelf that gradually narrowed to a mere ledge. I couldn't risk crawling and knocking off a loose rock. I had to do it standing up. Staying as close to the sandstone wall as I could, I inched my way out. It was almost full dawn now. Sunlight, ready to burst, quivered just below the horizon. Still lucky, I guess. Just on the other side of the tree was a fault running from the canyon floor 50 feet below me, clear up to the top about another 150 feet. A chimney, a way out. Then I heard Eddie. Looking through the dead tree, I could see him. He was packing up the gear in camp. I calculated it to be about 100 feet back to where Ellen was. A third of that distance, I'd be out in the open, a sitting duck. Miraculously, I made it.
Look, and I was so worried. Eddie's out there. I heard him whistling.
Yeah, I found a way out, but it's no good. He can see me.
Eddie would kill you.
Right. Unless I can kill him first. I didn't really have a plan. There wasn't time for that. The big Navajo would be back soon, and that would be the end. So, off the top of my head, I quickly devised a scheme that stood a remote chance of working and presented the least danger to Ellen Leon. I'd go back out on the ledge just to the point where I'd still be hidden. Ellen would then get Eddie's attention by throwing a rock out of the roof hole. In that moment of confusion, I'd dash across to the juniper and hide somewhere back in the crevasse created by the fault.
How can you hope to defend yourself against his gun?
Now, let me worry about that. Just remember, don't give him any reason to shoot you. Don't scream or try to stop him from coming after me. I want him to.
But why?
We've got the edge, remember? Fear. And believe me, I'm scared out of my mind. Ellen was to wait approximately 15 minutes, then heave the stone. Once Eddie had been summoned, he'd have to set up the ladder. Hopefully, by the time he reached Ellen, I'd have found a suitable place to hide. She would tell him that I'd gone for the police, and she would supply him with accurate directions as to my escape route. Up to a point, everything worked perfectly. I was ready in my ambush when the sound of raised voices split the air.
I said you go first. I ain't never shot no woman before, but I ain't got no code saying I won't.
Take your hands off of me. Dr. McKee is gone. You'll never find him. He left an hour ago in that direction.
Come on, move it.
No. Robin, run! Run!
A single gunshot reverberated throughout the canyon, and a swarm of ravens exploded from a distant cliff. There was a sinking in the pit of my stomach. Ellen was dead. I would be next. I studied my position in the dark cul-de-sac, huddled behind a pinyon tree, between the wall and the crevasse. There were two ways Eddie would come looking for me. If he believed Ellen, he would approach from around the dead juniper, at which point I would have a split-second advantage. But my only defense would be a rock. I could throw it at him before he saw me, but my aim would have to be perfect. And what would I aim for? His head or the gun? If Eddie were cautious, he'd come from the other side, and I'd be too far from him to do anything at all. Then I realized that I was standing behind a weapon, the pinyon tree. I tore the sleeve off my shirt, wrapped it twice around one branch. There was adequate pull, if only it wouldn't snap. And my hand throbbed violently.
McKee, I had to shoot your woman. Killing you is going to cost me $30,000. Don't make me do it.
Eddie was on the ledge. I had the branch secured, my pocket knife poised. I could see his left shoulder and part of his back. He had to take one step more. He did, and he saw me.
McKee!
Eddie's reflexive leap had carried him off the ledge into the crevasse. I looked down at him. He was caught in an awkward jackknife sitting position between the rocks. He was bleeding from the nose, mouth, and ears. His pistol lay on a shelf about halfway down. There was no chance I could reach either.
I fell off.
Yeah.
I was going to draw $45,000. 15 when they were finished, and 30 if nobody knew about it. Year from now. I got no feeling in my arms.
Eddie, who's Girlie? What are you people doing in here?
George was getting more because he made the contract.
Eddie, where's George coming back?
George moves out of Los Angeles. He'll kill you and your woman. Then he'll go away.
Didn't you kill him? Eddie!
Ellen had taken one bullet. It had cut through her cheek, deflected past the jawbone, struck the top of her shoulder, and tore out through the back of her shirt. But she was still breathing. I climbed down the ladder and returned with gauze and disinfectant. I bandaged her wounds and carefully moved her to the adjacent smaller room, then filled in the hole I had made to escape. Hopefully, George wouldn't find her when he returned. I had to get help or she'd bleed to death. Standing over her, I found that I was crying. She moved slightly.
Again?
Lie very still, Ellen. I'm going to climb out and get help.
Again. Be careful.
It was a struggle up the fissure of the cliff. Each precious second counted. Ellen Leon was everything that mattered. The sun was almost directly overhead. I found the wires. Two cables heavily insulated with gray rubber, almost invisible on the rocky ground. They ran in two directions. I was somewhere in the middle. I would have to guess which end led where. One would be connected to some sort of electrical gadget. The other might lead me to someone who could help Ellen's fiancé, Dr. Jimmy W. Hall. I headed northwest along a branch canyon. At the rim, the cable looped downward, disappearing under the brush. The canyon was much shallower than many ruins. Down below in the canyon, someone was hammering. Then I saw the truck. A green van, barely visible. I felt the pain before I heard the shot. Suddenly I was on the ground, gasping for breath. I had fallen and rolled into a clump of bushes. The sound of a two-cycle engine was coming from below. Probably a generator. Dr. Hall wouldn't have heard the shot above the noise. I looked down at my right shoulder and saw my own blood flowing from the wound. Then I heard him up above. On the rim, I knew who it was, even before I saw the black felt hat with the silver band. I dragged myself behind a fallen ponderosa pine, where it was cool and dark in the shadow. Just behind me were two saplings. I pulled myself up by a slack cable. The whole right side of my body was numb. The Navajo had circled below me. He was stalking me again, taking no chances. He knew I'd been hit. My blood was all over the rocks. I remembered what he had said yesterday. Nobody gets away. I whittled feverishly with my pocket knife, shaping a branch into a lance. I had already stripped a section of rubber from the cable and tied it between two saplings, forming a catapult.
Well, Bergen, we meet again. If you'll hold still, I'll make it as painless as...
The shaft struck him low in the chest and carried him 10 feet backwards. I crawled out of the thicket to where the big Navajo had fallen. His mouth was wide open and his eyes were glazed with a look of death. I picked up the wolfskin and the rifle. It wasn't the same weapon he had before. It seemed incredibly heavy. I stumbled toward the sound of the generator.
Put down the rifle.
Out of the corner of my eye, I saw the red baseball cap. The Indian boy was standing behind a clump of willows beside his horse, the reins dragging. He held a short-barreled rifle in his hands. It was pointed directly at my head.
Where's the other witch?
Well, he's dead. I killed him. This is his witch skin. Look, I'm not a witch. I'm one who teaches in school. Please, there's a green truck down there. You must let me get to that truck. The man there will help me.
All right. You walk. I will follow.
The van was parked in a thicket just off the canyon floor. Beside it, a generator was running. Suddenly, a man appeared in the doorway of the van. My vision was blurred, but I could see he was blonde and wore a denim jacket.
What the hell happened to you?
Got shot.
Who are you? How'd you get here?
Don't talk. Listen, are you Jim Hall?
How do you know that?
Tell this boy here I'm not a witch.
What?
Ellen Leon's been shot. She's up at that big cliff dwelling in the canyon.
Did you say Ellen Leon?
Man shot her. Needs help.
Who shot her?
Man named Eddie. He fell.
What happened to Eddie? Tell me, where's Eddie? Was there a man with him? Where's the man who was with him? Answer me, damn you!
You must help Ellen. She's dying.
You were right, boy. This man is a Navajo wolf. Give me your rifle. Put the rifle in the truck, then. We'll tie him up and go find the police. Hand me the rifle and I'll put it in the truck.
Oh, don't give him the rifle.
That's right, Billy. Don't give it to him.
Joe!
The party's over, Mr. Hall.
I was aware first of the vague, sick smell of ether. Then the feel of hospital sheets, the cast on my chest, and the splint bandaged tightly on my right hand. The room was dark. I saw the silhouette of a man standing by the drawn shades. From the slight paunch, I knew it was Joe Lepon.
Bergen?
Did you find her?
Sure, we found her before we found you.
Was she?
She's right down the hall. Broke her cheekbone and shoulder, lost some blood.
Will she be all right?
Oh, she heals faster than you. You've been in here 2 days. You've got more Navajo blood in you now than I do. Doc said you had a busted oil pan, took 10 gallons.
Yeah. Does she know about her boyfriend?
Yep, I told her everything. She was more concerned about you. Hall's dead, you know.
Yeah?
Walked right away from me into the truck, locked himself in and shot himself. Walked right in with me standing there.
He must have been crazy.
Crazy to get rich. You call it ambition. Sometimes we call it witchcraft. You remember the origin myth when first woman sent the heron diving back into the fourth world to get the witchcraft bundle? She told him to swim down and bring back the way to make money.
Yeah, knock off the philosophy, Joe. Look, what took you so long to find us?
You can thank Billy Nez for finding you at all.
Billy Nez? Horseman's brother?
The kid with the red baseball cap.
That was Billy Nez? Well, did he find Ellen, too?
I've noticed this before. Bella County women are smarter than you Bella County men. Miss Leon got a hold of some kerosene and made herself a smoky little fire. You could see it for miles. Now, why didn't you think of something simple like that? Climbing up that fault was showing off.
Yeah, how was I supposed to know you'd be wandering around out there? I thought the cavalry was supposed to arrive in the nick of time, not the Indians. Joe, I guess you know I killed those two men.
Not officially, you didn't. Officially, Dr. Canfield and Jim Hall were killed in a truck accident. Miss Leon and you were hurt in the crash. And officially, Eddie Gill and George Johnson never existed.
What was going on in there anyway? What was Hall doing?
It's a secret.
Like hell it's a secret. If you want me to tell some phony story about Canfield getting killed in a truck wreck, you don't have secrets.
I'm not supposed to know myself.
Know what?
Did you notice that Hall had portable radar sets all over the plateau?
Well, I noticed the wires. In fact, it probably saved my life.
Hall was set up directly under what the military calls its bird path. When the birds flew over from the Tonopah Range on their way to White Sands, Hall's radar was feeding information into a computer right in the van. Hall was putting it onto tapes.
Yeah, but how did Hall get mixed up with the other two?
A common interest. Money. They all work for the same organization.
Who? What organization?
One that's always interested in money. They're too big to fool with. George Johnson was a known associate. The FBI knew him as George Thomas, Amos Raven, and the Big Raven, too. A relocation Indian. California Navajo.
I knew he was a stranger. I heard him talking about the litany of were-animals. He had it all wrong, or at least it was another expert's opinion, not mine.
Well, that's what had me hung up. I kept expecting him to act like a Navajo, but he was acting like a white man.
Well, thanks a lot.
If he was a Navajo, no matter what he was doing in there, killing horsemen would have screwed it up for him. You put it together, a lot of money and a killing, it's not natural, and it's not Navajo.
Why did he kill horsemen? Hey, come on, Joe. It's all part of the same truck accident.
Well, Johnson was working on clearing an access road so they could get to the radar sets more easily. While he was busy, somebody sneaked down to the truck and stole Johnson's hat.
Why? I mean, you were wondering about that.
Sam George Takes told me the Nez family was preparing an enemy way. Well, they needed the scalp from the wolf for the ceremony.
And Johnson's hat?
Billy Nez took it.
Huh. Boy, he really gets around.
Then from what I said at Shoemaker's about horsemen.
Yeah, I understand, Joe. But what I don't understand is why Johnson wanted me to write that letter. I know they didn't want anybody coming in there looking for us, but they were finished. What difference would it make if we were dead or alive?
Think about it. If you have a bunch of computer tapes giving the exact performance of the other guy's ballistic missile system, it's worth a bunch of money. But it's worth a lot more if the other side doesn't suspect you've got it. Right?
Because if he suspects, he changes the system. Right?
Well, that about does it, my friend. Oh, this is for you.
Oh, thanks. Your letter? Hey, who opened it?
I did. It's from Miss Leon.
Oh, why did you open it?
Emma wanted to know how many were coming to dinner on Sunday. I'll tell her to set the table for four.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
That concludes this week's production of The Zero Hour.
Tony Hillerman's The Blessing Way. Next week, we'll begin another exciting dramatization of a tale of mystery and suspense. We'll tell our story in 5 days, at the same time, Monday through Friday. So on Monday, rest your eyes and listen here to The Zero Hour.
Today's episode brought to you in part by Metropolitan Life Insurance Company and Ford Motor Company. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in Monday. And once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.
This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.